So we are going to start the talk in the next few minutes. Yeah, good evening. I welcome all of you for this talk organized jointly by IEEE Computer Society and IEEE Power and Energy Society, IEEE Vizag Bay section. And I welcome Dr. Sandeep, Chair, IEEE PES Vizag Bay section, and I welcome Dr. Satish, Chair, IEEE Computer Society Vizag Bay section. And I also welcome and introduce to you today's speaker, Dr. Karthik Seshadri. He is the head of the Department of Computer Science and Engineering at National Institute of Technology, Andhra Pradesh, Tadepalligudem. Welcome to you, Dr. Karthik, for the talk on enabling positive use cases of AI to meet sustainable development goals. I welcome you on behalf of IEEE Computer Society and IEEE Power and Energy Society, IEEE Vizag Bay section. And I will introduce Dr. Karthik to all the participants. Dr. Karthik is currently working as assistant professor in the Department of CSE at NIT Andhra Pradesh, who has done his undergraduation at Tyagarajar College of Engineering, Madurai, and then post-graduation from NIT Tirchi. And he worked as IT associate in Morgan Stanley, Mumbai, and later worked as assistant professor in the Department of CSE at Tyagarajar College of Engineering, Madurai, and PhD in Information and Communication from 2012 to 16. And for his achievement, he received the gold medal for CGPA of 10 out of 10 in M.Tech at NIT Tirchi. And he is a recipient of Regional Engineering College Alumni Association Outstanding Student Award in 2010. He has cleared several international certifications by IBM, BrainBench, Coursera, and Oracle, and who stood in the top one percentile in several prestigious national exams like GATE, NET, ISRO's Scientist Exam, and SLET. And he obtained All India rank of 3 in National Eligibility Test in Computer Science in December 2015, and All India rank 1 in ISRO Scientist Examination in 2018. He carried several collaborative projects with IT organizations like Yahoo, Honeywell, Nokia, LinkedIn, and other high learning institutes. To his credit, he has several peer-reviewed Science Citation Index journal papers and prestigious conference papers. He authored a book on discrete mathematics for computer science and several book chapters on applications of AI to solve society-relevant problems. And he conferred with the honor of being a PhD supervisor at Anna University, NIT AP, and Griffith University, Australia, to guide research scholars. And he is passionate about teaching algorithms, artificial intelligence, machine learning, and programming, and equally passionate about research, music, traveling, and exploring the world. Thank you, Dr. Karthik, for accepting our invitation and being a part of delivering a lecture today. We are grateful that Today you are associated with IEEE Vizag Bay section to deliver a talk on your area of expertise of applying artificial intelligence for sustainable development goals. I welcome Dr. Karthik. Before going to start the session, I request Dr. Sandeep, Chair IEEE PES Vizag Bay, just to give some opening remarks. Who has taken this initiative of organizing this talk today? Dr. Sandeep, over to you.
Hello, very good evening all. On behalf of IEEE Foreign Energy, for Electronics and Industry Application Joint Chapter, so I welcome all the participants. Special greetings to Dr. Karthik Seshadri, who is my colleague at NITAP. I hope all the participants are going to enjoy his lecture, and he is a good teacher at our institute, and also he works on interdisciplinary projects also. I hope the participants will grasp this kind of, you know, motto from this talk today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Sandeep, for your initiation in organizing this talk, and we thank you on behalf of IEEE Computer Society and Vizag Bay section also. Now I request Dr. Satish, Chair IEEE Computer Society, Vizag Bay section, to give his opening remarks.
Thank you, Badri Garu, and really it's an honor to have this talk, because Karthik is, I know he's always a busy person, because my colleague is working under him. They said how simple he is and how easily he will give the solutions for really, it's a great evening. Karthik is going to give deliver on a very good topic. So my suggestion to all the participants to enjoy this talk and interact with him and make use of his whatever innovation he's going to do, and try to interact and get more things from this talk. Thank you very much. Thank you, Vidya.
Thank you, Dr. Satish, for your opening remarks. And even though our chair of IEEE Vizag Bay section, Dr. S. Lakshmi Narayan Garu, is not present, he may join. We thank him because of his motivation always drives us in conducting events of this sort. And we thank Dr. Lakshmi Narayan Garu and Dr. Chisti, Secretary IEEE Vizag Bay section. And now, before going to the talk, just I'm going to give you the overview of today's talk. And today's talk is on enabling positive use cases of AI to meet sustainable development goals. As we all know that artificial intelligence is an overreaching term for a collection of technology algorithms and approaches that allow machines to perform human-like cognitive functions such as reasoning and learning. And there are some quotes which are opposite to AI, like a variety of perspectives about AI and its potential impact on sustainable development. Some may say that AI is a job killer. Some may say that it is a tool that benefit wealthier nations and citizens. Some may comment that AI could pose existential threats. For example, Stephen Hawking warned that AI could lead to the end of the humanity. However, AI promises and is starting to deliver benefits across sectors and geographies and holds great potential to help solve complex and interconnected sustainable development challenges such as climate change, access to healthcare, and inequality. Whether we know it or not, AI is now part of the fabric of our daily life. For example, AI helps power predictive Google searches and Spotify music recommendations, Waze driving directions, and Facebook facial recognition. AI is also being used to address sustainable development challenges, improving the diagnosis of various diseases, fighting wildlife poaching, and improving crop yields, to name a few. And over the last 2 years, we have seen a considerable increase in discussion about the role of AI, which can play in sustainable development issues. As artificial intelligence becomes more widely adopted, we have a tremendous opportunity to reevaluate what we have created and ensure that AI is developed collaboratively and applied to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals to achieve a better and more sustainable future for all. In this direction, today's talk by Dr. Karthik Seshadri on enabling a positive use case of AI to meet sustainable development goals will definitely be a step ahead in achieving the sustainable development goals as recommended by United Nations. Thank you very much, Dr. Karthik Seshadri. Over to you now to deliver the lecture.
Badri garu, take him as a presenter.
Yeah, yeah. I think Dr. Karthik can share the presentation now.
Yes. Dr. Karthik, are you able to hear?
Karthik?
Yeah. I made, because everything is clear here. One second.
Get this problem.
Now you can share your screen.
Sure. Can you see my screen now?
Yes, yes, it is visible. Yes. Go for slideshow, sir.
Sure. My slideshow is visible as well, right?
Yes, yes.
Right.
Yeah, you can take over the session, right?
Thank you. Uh, Good evening to all who have assembled here on this Sunday evening. So the topic given to me is enabling positive use cases of AI to realize United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. But before we commence the session, I would like to thank Dr. Sandeep, and who is the head electrical engineering in NIT Andhra Pradesh, and Dr. Shankar, who is an assistant professor and associate dean RNC in NIT Andhra Pradesh. I would also like to extend my thanks to Dr. Satish, who extended a warm welcome to me for delivering this session, and the other members of the IEEE Vaisakh Day section. So with that short prelude, let me just commence my presentation. So what we see here in the current slide, right, these are beautiful sustainable development goals purported by the United Nations organization. So as we can see from these slides, these are wonderful goals, right, like no poverty, zero hunger, good health and well-being, quality education, gender equality, clean water and sanitation, affordable and clean energy, decent work and economic growth, industry innovation and infrastructure, reduced inequalities, sustainable cities and communities, responsible consumption and production, climate action, helping life below water to thrive, life on land, peace, justice, and strong institutions, and achieving these through partnerships, mutually beneficial partnerships. So these are excellent goals. So today's talk will focus on how to leverage AI to meet at least some of these goals, and what are some of the use cases which are in vogue today, which has successfully leveraged AI towards this direction. So a little bit of history is in order before we commence any involved discussion on the use cases. Let's set a common stage across all the participants. Before the onset of the first industrial revolution, I believe the first industrial revolution, it happened somewhere between the 1760s to the 1840s. We were predominantly dependent on either the human or animal muscle power for accomplishing tasks. And after the onset of this first industrial revolution, we began harnessing fossil fuels, wind, steam, water, etc., to generate artificial power to do our tasks. Now at the flip of a switch, we command as much as 250 horsepower of energy to build skyscrapers, roads, cities, etc. And we've also created electric grids to distribute the power to devices at homes. So broadly, we can visualize this first industrial revolution as electrification of mechanical devices, right? And after that, we entered into the era of second industrial revolution, where we are witnessing a surge in AI technologies, artificial intelligence-based technologies, which broadly we can think of as cognification of these electrical appliances to make them smarter. So earlier we had these mechanical devices which we electrified, and now we are adding intelligence to these electrical appliances in an attempt to maybe replace human mental power or cognition with what we call as artificial cognition. Can someone tell me what is this machine that we are seeing here?
Is that the Enigma?
Yeah, that's absolutely right. So this is the Enigma machine, right? And the person who's standing before the Enigma machine can be
Alan Turing.
Yeah, exactly. Great. So during this World War 1939 to 1943, right, the Alan Turing designed this Enigma machine that broke German ciphers, right? And this is history. We all know that. And helped the Western Allies to clinch victory. So post this discovery, right, he wrote a paper which is entitled, I believe, Computing Machinery and Intelligence in 1950. And the paper began with the following sentence. So he asked a very intriguing question. I propose to consider the question, can machines think? So with this simple visionary question, the entire domain of artificial intelligence and cognition broached. And an array of research has started to see what sort of models and what sort of techniques can be built to make machines smarter, especially when it comes to language, vision, and speech processing. So inspired by such a visionary and thoughtful question by Alan Turing, if we try to answer this question, right, what is this AI? So usually, you know, even engineers, scientists, everybody has some sort of notion of AI, right? And however, right, I really do not think, you know, none of us, in fact, including me, we comprehend the full, you know, spectrum of its definition. So typically we consider intelligence as a one-dimensional entity, right? So for example, it's usually the case that we consider microbes are sort of, you know, smarter than plants, bugs are smarter than microbes, reptiles are smarter than bugs, and animals, you know, or mammals are smarter than reptiles and so on. However, I think, right, I mean, it would not be an overstatement if I say our intellect has a very poor understanding of intelligence. So as someone very famously mentioned, I don't remember the, you know, like the person who proposed this quote, intelligence is a symphony of different notes, he remarked, each produced by a different instrument of cognition. Right. So, for instance, there are several dimensions to intelligence. So we have deductive intelligence, generative intelligence, spatial intelligence, emotional intelligence, and so on. And even animals have a symphony of intellect too. So, for instance, the long-term memory in a squirrel, it's proven to be better than that even in human beings. And it can clearly remember a map of where it has hidden its nuts even years later. To put things in perspective, right, of course, this picture looks very naive in what it conveys, but I think it sums up the sort of, you know, higher order intelligences that we can realize by, you know, like aggregating or integrating the lower order intelligence in the right amount of proportion. So for instance, we do have arithmetic devices, right, computing devices, which are better in terms of arithmetic intelligence. And several software applications, along with some spatial database and the memory that's represented using you know, proper spatial indices like GPS, that exhibits a very good navigational intelligence. And of course, we have Google that have what we call as this long-term memorization intelligence. They complement each other nicely, and when integrated, can provide us with a very useful application in the form of a self-driving car. So our initial attempts at creating AI, they were predominantly through mimicking the source of our natural intelligence, that's our brain. But of late, this way of approaching AI is blurring slowly, right? So recently, we could find the emergence of probabilistic graphical models. We could evolve a lot of different models which are other than neural network-based models to mimic the human intelligence and to deal with uncertainty, which is prevalent in the domain of vision, speech, and natural language. But however, our initial attempts at creating AI are by mimicking the source of our natural intelligence, that's our brain. The image recognition and cognition, right, that's one of the intelligent tasks that humans do. And let's first see how this human vision works before you know, we look at some models for handling computer vision. So if you look at how we solve vision-based problems, visual signals from our retina, gets relayed through our brain to what we call as this primary visual cortex, which is at the back of our brain. And signals there are separated and processed by three different processing subsystems, as you see here. And each of these subsystems is responsible for segregating color, shape, and contextual information like movement, location, and organization of various objects in the image that we see. So our brain, in fact, it's made up of gazillions and gazillions of neurons, and they communicate with each other and process information, right? And it has taken us thousands of years of evolution before our brain has reached this current stage of evolution ladder, right? And this is, of course, a very, you know, infamous model that all of us are aware of and we have seen. So AI is primarily based on creating these artificial neurons that mimic the biological ones. So there are several different similarities between them, right? We have as such tried mimicking the different biological cell structures in the ANN that we usually create. So you have dendrites here, and you have these, input paths, right, that's fed to a perceptron or a neuron. And there is a processing logic here, which we call as the cell body, and there is an axon, and there is a terminal axon that relays the output of this neuron activation to the successive neurons. Similarly, you have activation logic here, and you have an output link that connects this neuron to the subsequent neurons that comes in the pipeline. So this is the architecture of one perceptron, and we just like created a network of these perceptrons to attack problems in domains which have high degree of nonlinearity. So for instance, if you look at the speech, natural language and vision domains, they have inherent nonlinearity in the domain. Which means you cannot use some linear models, simple linear models to express the relationship between the input and the output, right? The task that we need to perform. So such complicated interrelationships we were able to conveniently represent with the help of these interconnection of neurons. And we were able to put them to use for solving tasks, right? So one such task, right, is this image classification task, which we see here. And the model that we see here is one of the state-of-the-art deep learning model that performs this task of image classification. It is divided into multiple layers and sub-layers. In the input layer, we have this raw input, which is the pixels of an image, which is usually considered as a set of 24 bits, an array of 24 bits. Each which represents this RGB components, right, using 8 bits each. And a pipeline of neural network has been constructed here to understand different semantic abstractions about the input image. So for instance, each of these layers can recognize different properties of the image and can implicitly extract and engineer features from the input. So for instance, here in this model, layer one, it can recognize edges, blobs, etc. And layer two can aggregate the knowledge obtained from the previous layer and can recognize textures. The next higher layer can learn to recognize object parts or what we call as regions of interest. And finally, the last layer can classify the input images into multiple classes of interest, like dogs, cats, and so on, right? So to put things largely into perspective, so if you look at the broad domain of development which has happened in the recent past, so we have the domain of AI, which earlier had some other connotation, right? So which earlier had this traditional connotation to it, which is predominantly considered to be creating intelligent machines and programs. And ML is one way of actually creating artificial intelligence by feeding some examples, training examples for machines, and by looking at the relationship between the input features and the output in those examples, we developed learning algorithms that automatically learned the relationship between the input and the output, and it generalized that relationship very cleverly to unseen test samples. So that's the domain of machine learning. And a very subset of models, right? ML models are what we call as deep learning based models, which uses deep artificial neural networks as their modeling methodology to learn and to perform these cognitive tasks. And however, the domain is evolving, right? So recently we see a lot of papers that try the approach of using probabilistic graphical models as a way to deal with uncertainty and to mimic the human intelligence. And some of the papers are also working in the domain of merging deep learning models and also probabilistic graphical models to deal with uncertainty in a better way. Now let us have a look at a couple of use cases of the technology that we have just had a very brief introduction to. And see how this technology has been put to use in the recent past towards meeting some of the UN's SDGs. Of course, some of these use cases are not per se directly relevant to the SDGs, but I would like to stitch a chronological timeline of how things has evolved in a certain way discuss the state of art that we are in today. In 1997, right? So this Deep Blue supercomputer from IBM, it defeated the then chess world champion Garry Kasparov. Of course, it's a very old event, but the sort of the AI program that did it, right? So that was one of a kind at that time, and that paved way for a lot of the AI researchers subsequently to leverage whatever thought process was used by IBM to solve this problem. But however, until very recently, even though this breakthrough happened in 1997, until very recently, if I remember correctly, until 2016, computers were relatively inefficient when it came to dynamic games, right? Like this Go. The Go game, right? If you look at this Go game, the rules of the game, it's extremely complicated, and there are several dynamic moves involved. It's quite complex. However, this AI was unable to match the human competence in such dynamic games. Recently in March 2016, right, as we can see in the slide, Google's AlphaGo bot, it defeated the world Go champion. And this was made possible due to the extensive training which is received by AlphaGo by playing, you know, like millions and millions of games against human players and also against itself. Right. So this is how AlphaGo learned like how to beat the human expert. And in fact, the best, you know, player of AlphaGo in today's world, it's actually a computer, not a human being. And the next application in which AI has helped us a lot in the recent past is the sort of route suggestion application that we see today, right? So reducing, if you look at this application, right, the application itself looks very simple. Reducing transportation time, it's not at all a trivial task. A single travel, if you look at it, may involve multiple modes, like driving into a railway junction and then traveling through the rail network and then walking or sharing a ride to the destination. And you have several dynamic factors which can play havoc, right, to the static routes that this AI bot plans, like traffic, weather, you know, construction, maintenance, roadblock. These all can cause impediments and can, you know, cause havoc to the route planner AI. However, some of the navigation applications are quite smart of late, and they exhibit so much of dynamism and uses a combination of learning theoretic approaches, right? Like deep learning, reinforcement learning. A combination of these approaches is being used to represent knowledge and to represent uncertainty and non-determinism in the domain, and to suggest the best possible routes for the commuters. In fact, right, like Google recently it acquired a startup called Waze. I think if I say recently, that would not be correct. I think this happened somewhere in 2013, if I'm not wrong. And it's a crowdsourced traffic app, and it uses anonymized location data from smartphones to predict traffic density and to suggest quicker routes for commuters. This is one area which is usually an overlooked area by researchers, in which we see AI helping in a big way, right, for commuters. And another seemingly important application of AI, in fact, this represents a class of applications to which AI is being put to use these days. It's what we call as resource provisioning and resource planning, right? So demand prediction and resource provisioning and planning sort of applications. For instance, what we see here is a console from Uber's demand prediction and fleet management application, which aims to minimize the waiting time of customers and to incorporate dynamic pricing. Uber actually uses an ML algorithm to predict demands across different regions of the city and to generate a heat map, right? And based on these predicted demand concentrations, Uber strategically positions its fleets of cars so that when customers' demands are higher in a particular region, more fleet of cars could be located around that region. And you can also do dynamic pricing, right? Depending upon the demand concentrations, you can go for dynamic pricing and things like that. And this is a very sophisticated, you know, like deep learning based model that is in vogue today. And another domain in which a lot of research is going on when it comes to deep learning AI and ML and probabilistic graphical models is this AI-based pilots. Of course, this autopiloting mode, it's not new to us, right? So we have had such applications in the cockpit of flights dating back to 1940s. 1914, I think, right? And depending upon how we define autopilot, we can even argue that it dates back to 1914. So typically, right, if you look at an average flight of a Boeing plane, it involves only hardly 5 to 7 minutes of human steered flight. And that too, it typically happens during takeoff and landing, right? And during all the other times, it's the AI bot, right? And the set of AI applications on the cockpit of the flight that manages the flight, the entire flight. So it's almost surprising for us to see that even we have started entrusting our lives to the AI bots, right? So we have even entrusted our lives in safely commuting us to our destination, right, to the AI bots. And another allied application, right, of AI, which is coming up which is coming up very high in the recent times. It's in scheduling flight takeoffs and landings, especially on very busy airports, right? By scheduling, we refer to the order in which different flights take off and land. in different runways in an airport. Such critical applications, right, it helps in ensuring security of air traffic by nullifying the impact of human errors on air traffic control, and AI is helping folks in a big way. In fact, even recently, right, we completed a project with Honeywell R&D, which is in terms of automating some of you know, the failure mechanisms that is being done manually by pilots, right, the switching over and failure mechanisms on the cockpit. That was a recent project that we carried out with Honeywell R&D. So AI and probabilistic graphical models and deep neural nets are coming up in a big way when it comes to aviation sector. Right. Another very you know, very old application, if you talk about it, is the spam filtering sort of application, in which we have been using ML. Right. Even now, a lot of sophisticated models are being used. Right. Like even today, it's a research area. Even though people consider that, oh, what's in it, you know, a typical naive-based classifier can help in segregating the emails into you know, different categories and spam emails. This is still an emerging research area, in my opinion, and a lot of state-of-the-art models are actually being purported, right, in this domain, especially based on probabilistic graphical modeling based networks. And of course, Gmail successfully filters 99.9% of spam these days, and it also auto-categorizes your emails as primary, social, and promotional sort, right, and it labels some of your emails as important and so on. And a supervised naive Bayesian AI classifier, it powers most of the spam filtering algorithms, as we have discussed. But still, in my opinion, right, we could do much better than this, right? So with the advent of IoT, access to our emails and things like that, we can AI can make our life much better and even easier than what we are seeing today. Another important area in which this AI is coming up in a big way, especially when it comes to you know, like online teaching delivery and automatic grading and assessment, right? It's in the use of models like Dirichlet processes and models like Latent Dirichlet allocation, probabilistic Latent semantic indexing, and so on, to just crunch an entire text document or the answer for a particular question by a student, and to project the answer into a quantified simplex space, like what we see here. So every vertex in the simplex space, it represents some kind of a concept, right, or a predominant topic that we expect in an answer. And you can mark one of these dots as the correct answer. And each of these dots, it represents the projection of a student submission, the vector space, the simplex projection of a student submission. And the closer the student submission to the correct answer, more marks you can award to the student. Of course, it's a probabilistic simplex space, and we have several distance metrics available in the literature to tell you how close an answer is in the simplex space to the correct answer, right? So you have metrics like KL divergence, Enshin-Shannon distance, Earth Movers distance, quadratic I-square distance, and so on, which can be effectively used in automatic grading and assessment. But however, still we are a long way to go, right? And we have not yet reached the accuracy that is exhibited by a human grader, but still we have a long way to grow. And this is one of the you know, state-of-the-art research topics that we see a lot of papers coming up. Even if you look at the recent editions of you know, the IEEE conferences, ACM conferences for computer science, we see a lot of papers coming up in this domain. And another domain which we can focus on to assist the sustainable development goals, right, it's of course banking and finance. So most large banks, right, of course, they offer an ability to conduct all of your online transactions through a smartphone app or through a web app, which has in fact obviated the need for customers to physically visit the bank and do anything, right? And we rely on a lot of ML-based technologies, right? Like optical character recognition, security systems, fraud detection and prevention systems, and systems that can help, you know, the decision makers to carry out credit decisions, right? So for instance, this FICO, the Financial Regulatory Authority, it uses a decision tree based sort of classifier to decide whether to grant or reject loans by, you know, kind of predicting the credit ratings of the applicants and so on. This is another domain where as a researcher, we can contribute a lot, right? In case we are interested in banking and finance. The next domain, right, of interest to us is social networking and recommender systems. where again we see a lot of AI and ML based models picking up big time. So whenever you upload a pic on Facebook, right, it auto detects faces and it suggests friends in the picture whom you would like to tag. In fact, FB uses a very powerful face recognition engine. And this engine, right, it's not indigenously developed by Facebook. It was acquired by Facebook from a startup called Face.com for a rumored $60 million, and another startup called Faciometrics in 2012 and 16 respectively. So these are some applications, right, in which still as researchers we can contribute and we can leverage these platforms to realize the full power of these social networks, right, and can aid the society. So another interesting domain of interest for us is recommender systems, right? If you open your Netflix or any Amazon or Flipkart portals, you see products being recommended to you. And in fact, state-of-the-art recommendation engines, right, based on collaborative filtering algorithms and based on latent factor models, they are at play in making these recommendations. And of course, we all know about the Netflix $1 million challenge, right? So where Netflix called upon all the researchers to develop a recommender system and an algorithm that's more accurate than the Netflix recommender system. And of course, a team from UC Berkeley won the challenge with the help of an ensemble-based model. So all of this is history, and all of that is something that we know, right? And using all of this as researchers, our job now, right, it's to understand the state of the art and to apply ourselves to contribute towards, you know, furthering the state of the art and to realize better and powerful models. Of course, my guide, right, at IIT Madras, when I was pursuing PhD, he used to tell me that all models are wrong, right? So that's what is his categorical statement. Of course, he told me that all models are wrong, but some models are useful, right? So of course, I completely agree with this statement. So even though all models are wrong, we cannot fully capture the nitty-gritty of the random physical process that's happening around us with the help of a bunch of equations and try to learn the parameters of the equation. That's always a game that we can never win. But of course, we can capture all the the essential nitty-gritty of what we see around us into this mathematical model that we are learning or constructing, so that we can put them to better use. So that's how we have to look at and approach this domain of ML and AI. And again, the application is quite self-explanatory here. So we have state-of-the-art NLP models these days, right? So we have LSTM-based models, and we have several sequence models like hidden Markov models and things like that that assist us in developing such applications, right? So there are several things at play here. There is optical character recognition algorithm that recognizes whatever is there before you in the picture. And there is a language detection module, right? Model that recognizes the language. And there is a translator module that translates the NLP translator module that translates the text that we see here into the destination text. And there is the image stitching and reconstruction module that actually like restitches the image back into the original destination language, right, in which the user is interested to see the hoarding. So such applications are possible, right, because of the state-of-the-art development in the AI and ML research. And another predominant application in which we see AI coming up in a big way is in quickening up the web search, right? Of course, Google has state-of-the-art web search algorithms, right? You have PageRank algorithm, you have a lot of distributed inverted index-based structures in Google that facilitates us to search, right, the entire web in even sub-nanoseconds of time. However, we feel like it's not enough because information is actually growing in an exponential pace, right? So quickly it's becoming petabytes, exabytes, zettabytes, and so on. And it's actually superseding all known limits to the researchers and human beings. So more and more models and algorithms are being proposed by the researchers, as to how to store this huge information, how to extract knowledge out of this information, and how to facilitate the search, right, on this knowledge to look, to retrieve what we are looking for, what we are interested in. And again, the field of information retrieval, right, IR. So even though that's a kind of a decade old term, And still a lot of research is in progress in the IR area, especially in developing supervised and unsupervised models that facilitate dealing with such huge corpuses, right, which we call as web scale corpuses. Coming back to the next domain, right, of course it's a very important domain of interest to us these days, right, because we're all like affected by the pandemic, right? It's unforeseen disaster that we are all in, and AI can help in a big way, especially in times of distress like this, right? So let's see some representative applications people have built towards this medical field, right? Oncology is in fact the branch of medicine that deals with prevention, diagnosis and treatment of cancer, and what we see here is a very good deep learning based neural network, right, that's built by a startup called Apilas, this neural network that we see here, it's very easy to use, right? So you need not go to a lab for carrying out this test. You have a small kit, right? You have to puncture somewhere on your finger, and then you have to capture the blood clot on some substrate and show the substrate in front of your mobile camera, and there is an algorithm that runs behind the scene, right, that provides support with respect to identifying these, right, like identifying any infections, identifying the presence of leukemia or any inflammation in your blood and so on. So this is of great help, right, especially in times of pandemic where physical access to labs and medical facilities are very limited, right? And another interesting domain of application is the computer vision based algorithms as applied to radiology, right? And this field has seen a huge impact due to the ML models, right? This is a very peculiar field, unlike the other medical domains that we see today, because usually, right, if you want to train some radiology based model, we need lot of training data, right? So because radiologists look for thousands of different things that could be wrong in the CT scan, and it could take a while before ML models can completely automate the entire process, right? So for the time being, we use these radiology images, right, to identify different causes, like different fatal developments, right, like strokes, brain bleeds, endocrinal hemorrhage, pituitary, thyroid and adrenal based problems and so on. AI cannot fully automate what a radiologist does, but however, the state of the art models are such that these problems can be very quickly and to a large degree of accuracy, it can be identified very quickly by your ML model, and you can push such cases to the head of the queue in emergency room or ICU, which can save lives, right? So that's where we are, right? If we look at the computer vision based models as being applied to radiology, till date, right, in my opinion, AI still struggles when it comes to maintaining accuracy of these models, and we have a long way to go before we can call AI as competent enough on par with the medical experts. Let me now walk you through a use case, right, which is in fact a real use case that has happened, and how a research group at Hopkins University has taken up this use case as the motivation to build one of the state of the art, a targeted real time early warning system for identifying the sepsis disease, right? So what you see here is a patient who reported to the ER with just a foot sore, right? So when she reported to the ER emergency room, all she had was a foot sore, and she ended up staying in the hospital for 22 days, right? And when she came to the hospital, the doctors saw no real reason for any medical concern. So just to monitor her vitals, right, she was dispatched to the general ward, right? On day three, she started to develop the symptoms of mal pneumonia, and so they gave her the usual treatment of antibiotics, but her condition, it continued to worsen. On day six, right, she developed what we call as this tachycardia, which means her heart rate rhythm has accelerated dramatically due to some reason. And then she had trouble breathing on day seven, and she experienced a septic shock, right, on day seven. And usually when a person is in septic shock, right, the mortality rate is 50%, like 1 in 2 person, they die because of this septic shock. So immediately the doctors transferred this patient to ICU and gave every possible treatment to stabilize her condition. at her condition, it continued to worsen, and her kidneys started to fail, her lungs started to fail, and which eventually led to a multi-organ failure. On day 22, she expires, right? And in retrospection, right, if we look at the medical record of this patient, she received all the right set of treatments, but only that she received them too late, right? She got an infection that had eventually turned into sepsis. And when any infection due to sepsis happens, right, the body releases chemicals to fight off that infection, which in fact triggers what we call as a negative inflammatory response. And that in turn has led to a cascade of organ failures. And eventually that has led to the death of this patient, right? So in fact, doctors, they find it very hard to detect sepsis, right? So even if you look, if several academic experts or doctors, right, they look at the same medical record of the patient, they kind of stand in two groups, right, as to whether the patient has sepsis or not. It becomes difficult for a human expert to identify whether this is a genuine case of sepsis or not, right? And early identification of sepsis is very important to treat it in a timely manner and to avoid the mortality. So the researchers from this Hopkins University, right, they recently developed this targeted real-time early warning system, which is abbreviated as TRUES. This is actually like a model that they learned by collating the electronic health record or medical records of patients who had sepsis and who did not have sepsis. And based on the data that is obtained, right, they identified very good machine learning models, right, that identifies unique subtle symptoms in patients with sepsis and without sepsis. And the model is both, generative and discriminatory in nature. And it analyzes even the symptoms in the context of thousands of test results, right, in the EMR. And it looks at every signal in the context of every other signal, thousands of other signals, and a lot of correlations it's able to identify, to enable the medical experts to identify the sepsis at an early stage, right? So this is a very, very promising use case of how ML can help when it comes to, reducing the mortality rates. And another allied domain of ML, other than the supervised and unsupervised sort of applications, is what we call as reinforcement learning, which is usually put to practice in applications where we do not have any explicit control feedback, right? So just in case, let's say we deploy a robot to the Martian terrain, and we would like to find our way to navigate the terrain, right? So we want our robot to navigate through the terrain and to move around, right? So there's no predefined map of the terrain using which you can train this robot, right? The robot has to learn the stimulus on its own. So it models this problem as a reinforcement learning problem with no explicit control feedback available. So it comes up with a objective function, right? It models this as a problem to play, and it formulates a goal, and it trains to optimize this goal, right? So it wants to execute a sequence of actions that fetches the maximum reward for the agent, right, as formulated by the goal. And whichever a sequence of control policies leads this agent towards the maximization of the reward, that sequence of actions is what we call as the Q policy, right? So, and there are algorithms based on temporal difference learning and things like that, which represents this domain of reinforcement learning, right? So, for instance, this very simple picture represents how reinforcement learning agents work, right? So, let's say, for instance, this robot is learning how to walk, right? And there's no training examples for it, right? And this walking problem could be a very difficult problem for a robot because there could not be any training examples given to the robot on an unknown Martian terrain, right? So what it does is it executes an action, and it sees its current state, right, before and after executing this action. So after executing its action, if the vitals of the robot are very clear, right, so it gives a positive reinforcement. And after executing this action, right, if let's say the robot loses its center of gravity and it tends to fall, but it regains its balance, right? So then you give a little bit of a negative feedback. And if the robot falls down completely and it loses the center of gravity completely and it falls down, you give a maximum negative penalty, right? So to the robot. So if the robot learns by executing a sequence of actions and without any explicit control feedback given to the robot, It just executes the action and sees for itself what has happened, right? Is it closer to the goal or not? So if it learns a control policy by doing such a learning exercise, right, we call it as a reinforcement learning strategy. And contemporary algorithms, right, have started moving towards the domain of deep reinforcement learning. We are seeing a lot of researchers adopting deep reinforcement learning to develop models, especially in domains like vision, robotic control, and things like that. Right? We skip these slides. Yeah, another interesting application, as we see here in the slide, right? It's voice recognition. Of course, we have state of the art deep learning based sequence models and attention mechanism based models being proposed in the literature, which does a very impeccable job of identifying the voice and recognizing speech, right? And we're seeing several engines which are even agnostic to the pronunciation, the speed with which it's being uttered, and the local slang with which it's being uttered. It's even cognizant of the accent, right? You can train a NLP model, a speech learning sequence model, that is tuned to one accent, which can even work for other accents with the help of a little bit of a transfer learning based setup. And this is basically a clipping that I obtained from one of the recent papers in CVPR. That's a very good computer vision and pattern recognition based conference. So we have progressed to a domain where we can visually answer questions, right? So for instance, if you feed this image to a model, a deep learning based model, and if the model does not only generate the text that describes this picture, right? So it says that a little girl sitting on a bench holding an umbrella, it's also able to correlate the different nouns that we see here in the sentence to specific regions of interest in this picture, right? So where is this girl, where is this bench, and where is this umbrella? All of that is being correlated and highlighted automatically by the deep learning model, right? So it's one of the state-of-the-art models that was proposed in CVPR. And this is another paper that, I looked at in ICML 2016, right? Machine Learning Conference, a state-of-the-art A-star conference in computer science. And if you look at here, right, again, all we need to feed to this model or just like these images, and the model learns how to answer visual questions. It's absolutely amazing, actually, if you ask me. So if you feed this image and if you ask the model what is the sculpture made out of, it's able to answer metal. Right? It's not just restricted to this one question. Right? So you can actually feed different complicated questions, right, that requires a lot of cognition behind it to be able to answer such questions. We have reached such a level, right, in our NLP research, in our computer vision research, where we are able to do such tasks, which just a decade back was supposed to be impossible, right? We thought that it was impossible even a decade back. But with the advent of deep reinforcement learning, with the advent of LSTM networks, state-of-the-art NLP models, and even with the advent of advancements in computer architecture, right? So these models are very compute intensive, very memory intensive, right? They are usually iterative in nature. They take thousands of iterations to converge, and they need a lot of training data, right, to be able to learn properly. So up until recently, we did not even have computer architecture based facilities to support them. But now with the advent of different computing paradigms like grid computing, distributed computing, cloud computing, and with the advent of hardware advancements, right, like multi-core machines, many-core machines, and GPUs, and so on, and with the help of vector functional pipelines, where we are able to vectorize a lot of these computations at the architecture level. So at every level, we are seeing advancements happening in tandem that enables these use cases, not only at the software level, right, not only at the mathematics level. So we see commensurate advancements happening at every level. Like we have AI frameworks like CAFE, TensorFlow, Theano, and we see advancements at the programming language level, programming language libraries and features being stitched and embedded. And we see advancements at the architecture level, so on, right? And we see all of these happening in tandem to be enabling such use cases. And till date, right, like NLP is still struggling to deal with a lot of human emotions, right, which is a known fact, right? So in fact, this is an example that I have clipped from, one of the papers in ICML 2016 conference. where if you see, right, till date we struggle with sarcasm in a way, right? So for instance, if you look at the sentence, right, it's a sentiment classifier that we see here. In its rugged, cheap and unassuming way, the movie works, right? So if you look at the sentence, right, most of the ML models and NLP models, it will wrongly classify the sentiment of the sentence, right? So because you have a lot of negative nouns here, rugged, cheap, unassuming and so on are negative nouns. But the one phrase at the end of the sentence that says the movie works, it kind of flips the sentiment of the whole sentence, right? So similarly, if you look at this sentence, the best way to hope for any chance of enjoying this film is by lowering your expectations, right? So in fact, it's a very strong sarcasm being expressed here through the sentence, right? Until date, NLP models are struggling with sarcasm, even though they are able to successfully detect sarcasm in a limited context. But in a general context, they are still struggling, if you ask me, right? And this is another state-of-the-art research domain, right, which researchers can contribute. It's in text summarization. Even one of my PhD scholars, they're working in this domain. So given a huge chunk of text, right, the objective is to create a precis or summary of this text, right, at different levels of granularity, right, so that it's like creating precis at different levels of granularity. And recently researchers are focusing on topic based text summarization. See, for instance, when you as an electrical engineer, if you read a paper, right, you would not be interested in so much as computational aspects of this paper, right? So you would be interested in more of the use case of the paper, right? So the summary that I should create for you should be different than the summary that the bot should create for a person like me, right? So who would be interested more in the computational aspects of what is being expressed in the paper, right? So with a lot of interdisciplinary papers being written, articles being written, such personalized summarization, we need models to do personalized summarization. And it's one of the hot research domains that people are working on, right? And another state of the art research domain is this attention based question and answering, right? So where you feed a huge knowledge base to the model, right, the AI model, and the model is able to correctly identify which subsection of this knowledge base it contains answers to the question that's being asked, right? So that's made possible through state-of-the-art attention mechanisms and things like that, right? Sequence models and attention mechanism and things like that. Let me not go into the details because I don't have time to do justice if I go into the detail. And again, we can do a lot of innovation when it comes to agriculture, right? So I think, of course, food is a very basic necessity, and we should do all that is in our power and might to assist farmers, right, to enhance their productivity. And of course, one thing we have to remember in all this, right? See, most of these models are trainable, right? So the sort of correlations that we feed this model with the help of training examples, that's what it will learn, right? So whatever we feed this model, that's what it will learn. For example, if you feed this NLP model with a lot of swear words, right, it will learn how to swear, right? It will not help humanity in any way, right? So most of these ML models, they are at the mercy of the training samples that human beings provide. So we have a huge moral and ethical responsibility to, first of all, create these models for the betterment of society, right, and create these models for the benefit of the humankind rather than building models for destructive purposes and things like that. So that's one very stark warning that we see, a lot of ethical AI researchers issuing to the community at large, right? So we should understand that this is just a tool, right? And whenever we create such models, we should train the model for the benefit of humanity rather than using them for destructive purposes. And we should definitely use them for enhancing the quality of our life, right? And also to enable us to achieve the beautiful sustainable development goals that we saw in the first slide. And we should relieve ourselves of these mundane tasks, right? And as human beings, we should focus more on tasks, that requires creativity, that requires us to create such bots, right? And to exhibit empathy, among fellow human beings, right? So we should redirect our energy to such tasks and leave the mundane and routine tasks to these AI bots, right? So with that small note, right, I just wish to conclude my presentation. And to sum up, we have just seen a couple of use cases, right? Which or in existence, right, towards meeting these sustainable development goals proposed by UN, and the sort of technology that's you know, behind the scenes that enables these use cases, what we have looked at. And of course, I owe my thanks for creating this presentation to the state of the art lectures and presentations by Richard Socher, Suchi Saria, Neil Nee, and Hugo LaRochelle. Right? So with that, I thank the organizers for inviting me for this talk, and over to you, Dr. Satish.
Thank you, Dr. Karthik. Now we will take few questions from the participants. Yeah, I think participants can unmute themselves, and you can also chat if you have any questions.
Hey, Dr. Karthik. So this is Sai. So that was a really interesting session, and especially SDGs are something that I've been exploring at least for a year now. So I, to give a background, I work as a senior software engineer at Preqin, and I am working on building the ESG solutions at Preqin for the alternative assets and SDGs. And is, I mean, UN SDG and UN PRI are one of the areas, and we, I mean, we give out ESG ratings, or this product is basically giving out ESG ratings to fund managers and investors. Now, coming back to the UN SDGs that we have, so I have been using SDG indexes, which are given out based on the geography and the country level ratings that we have across all these 17 in, like, data points that you spoke of, right? The sustainable development goals. Now, when we are talking of applying AI to such a specialized area, the one problem that I see, or based on like whatever I've used so far, that I see is the data collection part. So like, you know, because not every source of data could be authentic. And if I understand SDGs correctly, currently it is all done by a centralized institute which gives out these indexing or indexes, correct? So now to open it up at a scale where we could apply AI to these SDG metrics, so what sort of limitations do you see currently with respect to the data availability against each of these SDGs?
That's an excellent question, Sai, and let me try my best to answer this question. Of course, data availability is a problem that we see, because most of these models, right, they need huge amounts of data, right? For in fact, there is a quote, right, that says, it's not who has the most intelligent model or the most sophisticated model that wins. It's that who has the most amount of data who wins, right? When it comes to some sort of accuracy, right? When it comes to realizing good performance metrics with these models. Of course, data is a very important you know, ingredient of any of these models. In fact, right, with the liberalization and the standardization of data formats, of course, we do have certain obfuscated data sets available. If not for all of these SDGs, at least for some of these SDGs, we do see lot of data being available, at least in obfuscated sense, where you don't get any private information, right? You don't get any identifiable information across these data tuples, but still you get the necessary vitals, right? Even when it comes to the electronic medical records, right? We do have certain organizations that make them public once in you know, with a specific periodicity, right? After obfuscating all of these touch points, and after a certain amount of you know, time has crossed, right? So that's one thing. And I do agree with your observation that for some of these SDGs, there's lack of data, there's dearth of data. And as researchers, how we can handle, right, that is through what are known as building generative models, right? So these generative models are some kind of stochastic processes, right, which are capable of generating synthetic data, right, which can mimic these real world physical processes which are happening. and that can generate synthetic data. So for instance, you can create some sort of probabilistic graphical model, right, as a stochastic process that captures all of the inherent patterns in the real world that you wish to capture. And this acts as a generator for you to generate the synthetic data. And based on the synthetic data, you can train a model and then see how accurate that model is, right? And if you feel that the model is the accuracy of the model is not acceptable enough for the sort of SDG that you're trying to realize, then you have to fine tune that model by doing a lot of iterations, right? So you have to go back to the generator, tweak some of its stochasticity properties, and then you have to make it generate some more discriminative data or generalizable data and retrain the model and so on. And this exercise you have to do for a couple of thousands of iterations until you have a model in your hand that's feasible or practical, right, which has a good amount of accuracy. It's in fact possible, some 10 years back this was not possible because we did not have the domain of probabilistic graphical models. Our understanding of nonlinearity or stochasticity or randomized algorithms, it was quite limited 10 years back. And we did not also have enough computational facilities 10 years back. But with the sort of trial and error that's made possible, right? It's not an impossible task, right? It's a difficult task. Of course, I concur with your observation. But it's not an impossible task. So the answer to your question is, yes, it can be done, right? It's not an impossible task, but it's a difficult task, right? So you have to you need to develop good stochastic models, right? You need to develop good generative models that can generate training data. And you need to be able to have access to good computational facilities, which can sort of retrain the model, which can iterate and retrain the model until a sufficient level of accuracy is realized.
All right. Okay, that makes sense. And a quick follow-up, probably unrelated to this. When we are talking of synthetic data, wherein the gap that we have in terms of data is going to be filled by something like this, and this is something again that is generated through a model, correct? So is there not a possibility, again I might be wrong here, but is there not a possibility where we might introduce a bias into the system as a process of this generation?
There is always a possibility for a bias introduction, right? And so of course we need to be able to quantify this bias, right, that we have in our model. And there are a lot of bias variance trade-off handling techniques available in the literature, right? So of course you must be aware of what is variance and what is bias, right? So we again have to do a couple of trials. There's no a fixed sort of method that we can use, right? And we need to be able to develop this model which can generalize to unseen test cases, right? So of course you have to cross validate your model and sort of assess how much of bias that it exhibits. And if you see considerable bias in the model, again you'll have to retrain your model, or you have to tweak the parameters of the model, right, so that the level of bias it exhibits is brought down. The bottom line is this: you need a lot of trials. Actually, there's no fixed strategy to overcome this bias. When you handcraft your model and when you sample from your training set, right? So maybe you can design a sampling strategy which is as uniform as possible, right? Which is the which does not introduce any accidental bias. But even after taking sufficient care, there is always a possibility of having an improper bias variance trade-off in your model, which needs a lot of trials. Actually, it's not doable in robotic precision. You need a lot of trials.
That answers my question. Thank you so much.
Any more questions from the participants? Yeah, if any queries are there, I think you can just post them to Dr. Karthik Seshadri to his mail so that he can answer. And thank you, Dr. Karthik Seshadri, for your lecture. on enabling AI to sustainable development goals, and starting from the first industrial revolution, from AI to machine learning to deep learning, you have touched a clear insight into different application areas, like how we can use this in medical diagnosis, how we can use this in aviation, how we can use this in finance, how we can use this in natural language processing and voice recognition. I think you have touched so many applications related to this. And as prescribed by United Nations to achieve sustainable development goals by 2030, I hope that there is a clear evidence of potential of AI to act as an enabler in achieving these sustainable development goals. I think definitely today you have given a clear direction how AI can be applicable in a broad classification of environment-wise, economy-wise, and societal-wise. So definitely, I think your talk will inspire so many participants to work and move their research in AI towards achieving sustainable development goals. Thank you very much, Dr. Karthik, for your lecture on this.
Thank you, Dr. Badri, for the kind invitation, and it's my pleasure to have interacted with the group. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. And before going to close this, I think just 1 minute, I want to present to you about IEEE Computer Society. And whoever participating in this talk, in this session, if they may be IEEE members or non-IEEE members also, if you are not an IEEE member, IEEE Vizag Bay section is going to organize several events, talks, etc. like this to help the professional community. If you are not a part of the IEEE, I suggest you to be a part of the IEEE community by taking the membership in IEEE. And you have several societies also, like IEEE Computer Society, IEEE Education Society, IEEE Power and Energy Society, Power Electronics, like that. And being I, myself, Dr. Badri, being the secretary of IEEE Computer Society, Vizag Bay section, just I will be presenting to you in the next 1 minute about what is the use of membership in IEEE Computer Society. If you are already a member of IEEE but not a part of the IEEE Computer Society, I suggest you to go with IEEE CS membership when you are renewing your membership, because this membership includes computer and computing edge subscription, career resources, plus professional development discounts. So whenever you are renewing your IEEE membership, add IEEE Computer Society membership also. And it is with the IEEE CS membership, it offers trusted content from 33 magazines and transactions, more than 9,000 conference publications, standards development, online learning with more than 45 professional development hours available. You can learn, collaborate, and network at 225 international conferences, 350 plus worldwide chapters, and 40 technical communities. IEEE Computer Society membership also offers beginning and advanced software development certification, deep discount on all conferences and events, leadership opportunities, including the opportunity to lead, publish, and speak. The fields of interest of IEEE Computer Society includes all major areas of computing and information technology, like the computer hardware, software, security, AI, multimedia, IT, networking, mobile computing, and many more. Right? So, those who are not a part of this IEEE Computer Society, if you are a member of IEEE, please subscribe to IEEE Computer Society membership. If you are a non-member of IEEE, I request you to go for IEEE membership. Along with that, I request you to register for IEEE Computer Society membership also. Now I feel it my privilege to present the vote of thanks, being the secretary of IEEE Computer Society Vizag Bay section. And I thank Dr. Karthik Seshadri, for his acceptance, because being an upcoming NIT, the NIT of AP, being the head of the Department of Computer Science, I think Dr. Karthik as well as Dr. Sandeep being the head of the Department of Electrical Engineering, we do understand that you have so many roles and responsibilities with the new developments that will be taking place in NIT AP. It clearly witnesses your interest towards the research. That is why, even though in spite of your busy schedule, you have accepted to share your knowledge with the community who are present or in the today's session. Thank you very much, Dr. Karthik, for your inspirational insight into the application of AI to sustainable development goals. Thank you very much, Dr. Karthik, for your time. And I thank Dr. Sandeep for his initiation in arranging this lecture. Being he is also heading one department, out of his schedule, busy with academics, research, as well as establishing different things in NIT AP in his own department. Still, he is active in IEEE Vizag Bay. So I also invite Dr. Karthik to take an active role and collaborate with IEEE Computer Society through his computer science department. I welcome you, Karthik, for this. This will help a lot for our professional community. I thank all the executive committee members of IEEE Vizag Bay section, chaired by Dr. S. Lakshmi Narayana under the secretaryship of Dr. Chisti. And I thank all the executive members of IEEE PES. I thank the chair of IEEE Computer Society, Dr. Satish, and all other my colleagues of IEEE Computer Society Executive Committee and other active participants of IEEE CS. And I thank all the participants for actively participating, and definitely today's talk will be useful for us to think in a different direction how we can apply AI, and being we academicians who are there here, we can take some initiation for through our scholars to have a research on applying AI in achieving the sustainable development goals. I hope that Dr. Karthik will help us in a direction towards the research in this area. I request you, Karthik, to help the participants, if anybody working in this area are guiding their scholars, please support them in this area of enabling AI in achieving sustainable development goals. Thank you, Karthik. I thank all the participants for participating in this. And we have many more events, upcoming events during the month of April and May. I request all of you to participate and make use of all these events. Now, this is going to end with national anthem.
No, Patrikar, before that, we have a photo session. Like, I request all to on your videos so that we have a photo.
Yeah, all participants, if you don't have any problem, please. Video.
I request all. Hi, Murli Krishna garu. How are you, sir? Your voice not audible.
Nice to see you, Satish. I'm just I just joined because I'm in the morning period here. Good to see you all.
So nice. Seeing you.
But anyway, I'm very happy to listen to the lecture because sustainable development is one of my favorite areas.
I know.
I really enjoyed it. So certainly, I think it's one of the best things which we recently talked. Thank you very much for a nice presentation also.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
We can do lots of things in SDG, particularly in these areas.
Yes, sir. Thanks for joining. And yeah, thank you, Garu. And our next event will be on 28th, sir. 27th, I think Sai also a part in this session. I think he's going to take on services, microservices. On 27th, again, we are going to meet. Thank you, sir. Once again, we have a beautiful picture with all of you. Badri Garu. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thanks a lot, sir. Thank you very much.
Yeah, now we have the national anthem.
Yes, sir.
Thank you everyone for participating in this. Again, we will meet you in the next event. Thank you.
Are important, but if you have to write essay.
Yeah, thanks, we are going to end the meeting now.
Thank you all. Okay. Bye.